Welcome to the fourth section on food safety, and this section is going to be covering food additives. We're going to start with just a basic overview of the types of food additives that's in our food supply. And we think about antimicrobials, antioxidants, artificial colors and flavors, bleaching agents, chelating agents, stabilizers, thickening agents, and then even nutrients. Now, initially we think about, for our antimicrobials, why are we using those? Well, we want to prevent spoilage, and we talked about bacteria that can cause spoilage versus bacteria that cause foodborne illness. So it's important to have additives to food to help prevent that growth of bacteria. We also want to have that delay of rancidity, and this is where the antioxidants come in. And you'll find a lot of antioxidants, including, you know, vitamin E, you'll see on a lot of products because that's an antioxidant. Adding color. We do have a lot of the, food coloring, food colors such as, you know, yellow dye, number 5. And this is of particular concern because some of these dyes have been linked to ADHD in children. So it's hard to take any of these additives and actually link them to certain diseases. But for the most part, most of the coloring agents have been approved by the FDA, are generally recognized as safe. But in the past, there actually have been food coloring agents that have been shown to be detrimental to health and actually pulled off the market. Because of the links with the food coloring, and we don't really need to have, a bright red, food, or a bright purple, or something that's not natural, not from a phytonutrient, a naturally occurring nutrient, but something that's added. There's no need for that. It's not preventing spoilage or increasing shelf life. And we have to think that coloring should be as safe as possible. There should be no risk whatsoever. If you do see the yellow dye number 5 on the label, my recommendation is probably to be to avoid that product. Or if you're a parent, this is really where you should keep an eye out for this on products. Flavor enhancers, you see these a lot, MSG, which we'll talk about. We've talked about sugar, certainly sodium, and these are all going to enhance flavor. We do have bleaching agents, which tend to whiten food. A lot of these are the peroxides. We don't really need to have the food white, so they have to be generally safe. There hasn't been really any association with the whitening agents associated with any health issues. We definitely want things that are going to prevent discoloration. And we think about the nutrients. I think you'll find a lot of the food, especially your processed grain products, especially some cereals or a classic example, have a lot of vitamins and minerals added to them. And I think there's a good quality to that because it does help. It's a fortified food, and it helps individuals obtain better nutrition, or at least of the micronutrients. The problem is there's also a certain feeling of confidence that you're getting all of your nutrients when, again, it is only your micronutrients. So I think there's positives and negatives to that. Certainly those are all safe sources. And of course there are, changing the texture of food, putting in thickening agents in, and those are also going to be very common. I want to talk a little bit about nitrates. So this is something that's going to preserve the food, it's going to prevent bacterial growth, and it's going to preserve the color of the food as well. Nitrates are commonly used in cured meat. So you'll see these in the cured meat. And we talked a little bit about this. You've seen this slide before. As I said that, when you see a big ball, a big ball of meat, you don't have a turkey breast that's this large. So, this is the water-laden, gummy, salty, uniformly shaped ball That's more like a sausage than a real meat. But most of these go through a curing process. It is good to have the curing because it will help destroy, in particular, bacteria that's going to cause botulism, which is a deadly disease. It slows the growth of listeria, which we talked about, and that's also something that gets contaminated more commonly in our processed meats, so the deli meats, two important things. The problem with nitrates is they're linked with stomach and colon cancer, associated with. We're not 100% sure that they're going to actually cause that. Remember, that's a cancer is multifactorial. There are many contributing factors, but nitrates are definitely associated with them. Again, if you're eating a processed deli meat, it's not a whole food. Of course, I wouldn't recommend that you're eating it anyway, but at least you know now why that the nitrates are used and why you might want to avoid them. Now, natural versus artificial flavors. I think natural, that term, we feel that a natural flavor is going to be so much better for us than an artificial flavor. Well, they end up being the same chemical formula. They are made by a flavorist, which is a chemist, in a laboratory. So your natural flavor and your artificial flavor are probably made by the same person in the same lab. Now, I want to just tell you what a natural flavor, what they have to do. They have to make that flavor from a natural product. So it could be an herb or fruit, veggie, spice, beef, chicken, yeast, bark, you know, any one of those, you can get the flavor naturally from those products. But here's the key. Now, if we looked at this and we wanted to make an almond flavor, you have to take peach pits, apricot pits, and bark. And you put those three together and you'll get benzaldehyde or an almond flavor plus cyanide. The cyanide occurs in all pits. That's why we shouldn't be eating pits, or at least in a large amount. But this is the natural way, is to get the benzaldehyde plus the cyanide. Now, again, this is done in a laboratory. Now, the artificial flavor is taking banana flavor, which is amyl acetate. So that's something that they had to make, so it's not natural. So that's why it's artificial, plus clove oil. And then you just get the benzaldehyde. You just have the almond flavor minus the cyanide. And this is the artificial way. In the end, you have the exact same chemical made in a lab, whether it's natural or artificial. And this is just an example of, why a natural flavor even though it sounds like it would be better, and it sounds like it'd be better for you, better for the environment, I mean, everything about it sounds better, it most likely isn't. Now I'm gonna spend a little time on monosodium glutamate. MSG. Now, MSG is generally recognized as safe, and there's been growing evidence about more problems associated with MSG as a food additive. It's very difficult to link some of these food additives in the food supply to health problems, just because this is just one thing you're eating in a massive amount of food, and then all the environmental contaminants, and there's genetics. So there are a lot of contributing factors. It's really hard to link the two. But there is some growing evidence, and I'm going to talk about why, what exactly that is. But what MSG does is it excites the taste buds. So it's going to make food more intense. It's going to make it taste better. It'll make it taste savory. And it actually occurs naturally in foods, and it was actually a Japanese scientist who isolated this in a sea vegetable called kombu. I think that's how you pronounce it. And it was used in a lot of broths in Japan. It occurs naturally in tomatoes as well. So there are a lot of foods that do have some glutamate or monosodium glutamate that occur naturally. What we found is that monosodium glutamate is actually they're calling an excitotoxin. And I'm going to tell you exactly what that is. But first, I just want to discuss that glutamate is a neurotransmitter. And what that means is it's involved in signal conduction in the brain. So it helps to transmit a signal from a neuron, a nerve cell, from one nerve cell to another. So you kind of have this chain reaction, and glutamate helps in the transmission of that. So glutamate's involved in signal transduction in the brain. It's a mediator of excitatory signals. So it's involved in development, cognition, and learning. The body regulates this. It's you don't want too much, you don't want too little. And that's one of the arguments for why people say that MSG is safe, is it naturally occurring in foods, and it also occurs in our body. Remember we talked about fructose and the fructose occurring in fruit. And when you eat that piece of fruit with the fructose, it's okay. The body knows how to deal with it. That fiber slows the absorption of fructose. You're getting micronutrients, phytonutrients, in addition to the fructose. When you take out the fructose from the apple or whatever piece of fruit and you concentrate it, and now you put it into a processed food in a high amount, we can't say that that's something that's naturally occurring anymore. This isn't something that's going to occur in nature and you're going to consume. It's in an exorbitant amount, and it's going to have a different impact on the body. Same thing with glutamate. It does occur in nature. But if you take it out of food and you concentrate it and you put it into processed food in enormous quantities, this is in enormous quantities, it's probably going to have some impact. And this is what some of the researchers have found, is that when you have too much glutamate, then we have the too much, it's probably causing some harm. And here's an example from this an article that was a neuroscientist talking about exactly what an excitotoxin is, or what excitotoxicity is. And I don't expect you to know this. I know this is a little bit overwhelming, but what happens is when you have too much glutamate, you overwhelm these receptors. And now the NMDA receptors are the main receptors for glutamate. What that causes is this influx of calcium, which damages the mitochondria. If you remember from your basic science classes that a mitochondria is kind of the workhorse, it generates all the energy. So you can't have that energy generation. In addition, it activates some enzymes, and in the process, this damages the neurons or the nerve cells in the brain. So really important for children. Remember we talked about this is in cognition and learning and development. So they're finding that the very young and the elderly are most susceptible to these really high levels of glutamate. So you really need to be aware, particularly all you moms out there, for looking for this in the food. Hydrolyzed vegetable protein and vegetable protein both are big sources of MSG. Yeast extract. Again, it's a naturally occurring source of yeast extract, but if we're going to concentrate that and put it into food in large quantities, it becomes a problem. Soy extracts and protein isolates. So it's not just, so you want to look for monosodium glutamate, disodium glutamate. It's in almost every broth and soup out there. Start checking the label. You will see probably one of these items in either your soups or all your chicken broths, beef broths, all of those. And then you also find it in a lot of the processed foods. So, and when we think of our chips and crackers in particular. So keep an eye out for this. Now this is the end of our section on food additives.